This is my milling machine, and I need digital readout unit, and I have these three linear scales. Let's make one using Raspberry Pi Pico. This project consists of three main parts: software, electronics, and mechanics. Today, I will cover the electronics and software parts. I will talk about the following subjects respectively. A linear encoder, scale, is a sensor that converts linear motion, position, and velocity into analog or digital output signals. I couldn't find much about them since they are obsolete, so I found the pinouts myself and explained how to do it in previous video. This particular glass scale has A, B, and Z output signals over RS-422 physical interface. By counting the pulses, the amount of the movement can be determined. There is a 90-degree phase shift between A and B signals. By looking at which of the A and B signals is leading, the direction of the movement can be determined. Choosing the microcontroller, we need to count the pulses on the A and B pins for each three axes, and we need to determine the direction for each axis. Since this linear scale's resolution is one pulse per micron, it generates a lot of pulses to count. Using GPIO interrupts at such high frequencies, it is just not suitable for this job. Ask me how I know. A microcontroller with a QDEC peripheral is usually required to count such high frequency pulses. Luckily, Raspberry Pi Pico has two programmable I/O peripheral called PIO, which consists of four state machines each and allows us to make fast GPIO operations without using CPU cycles. It also has USB controller that we can use as USB serial device to get the coordinates. Plus, it's cheap. Designing the circuit. We will connect the RPI Pico to the tablet via USB. To not drain the tablet's battery, we will make a self-powered USB device. To do this, we need to remove D1 on RPI Pico to disconnect VBUS from VSYS. Thus, the circuit's power is independent of the VBUS from the USB host, making it a self-powered USB device. The DC plug is used to deliver 5V DC to the circuit. There are two caps for decoupling, and polyswitch is used for overcurrent protection. Since there are three axes, we have three pairs of RS-422 line driver circuits. I use DS-8923 because I had these in my hand. We have two differential inputs, the encoders A and B pins. Each has termination, pull-up, and pull-down resistors. This is called fail-safe termination. You can find out more about it here. You may wonder why DN is enabled despite the output driver not being used. It's to reduce power consumption and the temperature of ICs. More on this later. Since we enabled DN, we need to handle unused input pins. I referenced this from TI's datasheet. Building process. I only included the important parts of the building process in the video. Wouldn't it be boring if I added them all? To test this particular circuit, I will use perf board rather than a breadboard, as the latter can be unreliable for high frequency circuits. If you don't want to lose precious microns, it is better to design PCB for a long-term solution. Making the circuit. First, I started with the layout of the components. Then I continued desoldering the pin headers to the RPI Pico. I used a few sockets temporarily to keep it from tipping over. When soldering the IC sockets, I start from the sides and then continued through the middle of those two to ensure that the sockets were parallel to the PCB. When using SMD adapter PCBs or modules and planning to remove them later, put some layers of double-sided tape under them for easy removal. To avoid any surprises, I checked the continuity and shorts every few steps and made sure everything was connected. When I mount parts such as resistors to the PCB, I keep the remaining wires. Well, you never know when it might come in handy. You can get these magnet wires from old, broken toy motors or cassette player motors. Of course, not the ones that suffered from the overcurrent in one of your mad scientist experiments. I prefer using colored ones because it makes easier to see when the enamel is peeled off somehow. This is how I use the soldering iron to burn off the enamel. Testing the circuit. When I build a circuit, I divide into sections as in the design process, then build and test it sections by sections. With this, you don't look for faults here and there. If there is a part that needs to be cloned, such as RS422 drivers, I will add those parts after the test. So I soldered to only the components needed for the one linear scale to test, then I started testing. While testing the circuit, I connected the drivers to the 5-volt rail. I noticed that the driver temperature was 39.1 centigrade degree. Since reducing power consumption will also lower the temperature, I connected the drivers to the 3.3 volt rail instead of the 5 volt rail and enabled DN. After doing this, the driver temperature dropped to 25.3 centigrade degrees. I know what datasheet says about minimum supply voltage. I tested it and it is working in this case, but always listen to what the datasheet says. To test a signal axis, I need to apply a known number of pulses and check the RPI Pico output to see if it matched. Since I don't have a signal generator, I made a circuit to generate 90 degree phase shifted signals using dual flip-flops to emulate encoder pulses. After testing, I soldered other components like RS422 drivers off camera. Then I soldered and wired the pin headers for all linear scales. Do as I say, not as I do. Do not use your fingertips to hold down the wires while soldering. Doing so may cause serious burns. Please use tweezers. Do not try to do anything else with a soldering iron in one hand, or you may burn something around you or even yourself. Breathing the fumes from burning magnet wire enamel can be very unhealthy. You need a good fume exhaustion system, not just a fan. Assembling the cables. I couldn't find receptors for these connectors, and even if I could, I'm sure those are not cheap. I removed the old connectors to replace them with cheap ones. I also removed the flexible conduit fittings for later use. It took some time, but I managed to remove all three of them. After searching on Amazon, I found this panel mount RJ45 waterproof connectors. It was about 5 bucks each, which is not bad. I started the installation with cable glands. Next, I install flexible conduit fittings. By the way, I got those scars while cleaning our air conditioner. Next, I installed the RJ45 connectors. Since there are 10 wires in total, 2 of them were left out. The remaining 2 wires were used for secondary power and ground. I removed them from the PCB and insulated them with the heat shrink tubes. Chassis, shield, and circuit ground are connected together at the linear scale end. To avoid a ground loop, the shield ground is left open at this end. Ground loops will create a source of noise, which will cause precious microns to be lost. With such short cables, I don't think it'll be an issue, but just in case. For the PCB side, I used these wired RJ45 connectors lying around. Then I put the female crimp pins. Software. I have already made up my mind. I will use PIO to count pulses. I checked GitHub before starting and I found this library. It's a quadrature decoder library that uses PIO and DMA and can count up to 2.8 MHz. Perfect! Thanks to the open source community for providing these libraries. I made a piece of software that uses this library to read linear scale pulses and sends them over USB CDC to the TouchDRO app. Let me explain how the software works. Basically, the software initializes PIO and the access pins. In the loop, it reads encoder values and sends them to the host. About the intervals. We must send the access values to the host with a maximum 1 second interval in the loop. Otherwise, the TouchDRO app will think it is disconnected. But sending access values in a 1 second interval makes DRO useless. So I came up with the idea of changing the interval if there is a change in any axis value. If there is a change, it sets the interval to the minimum value. If there is no change, it sets the interval to its maximum value of 1 second. Tweaking. You can remove any axis by deleting its pin definition. You can find everything in the repo, from compiling to running. Final test. I will be using the Android app called TouchDRO. Thanks to the author for providing such an app to us without ads. USB support will be available in TouchDRO version 3, which I think will be released soon or may have already been released. If you want a quick pick, apply the beta testing program. Finally, let's put everything together and test it. I open the app and tap the USB icon at the top of the screen. Then select the Raspberry Pi Pico and tap OK to allow the app to access USB. And that's it. I used a straight USB OTG cable because the tablet has an external charging port. Depending on the tablet, you can use Y-shaped USB OTG cables that allow you to both use the OTG function and charge. So, here's the list of junky but good condition parts that I use in this project to support the SDGs. The remaining challenges. I have to find a way to insert these seal rubbers into linear scales. If you know an easy way to do it, let me know down in the comments. Stay tuned for upcoming videos. And spoiler alert, I will release a video about DRO software with Zephyr Arduinos. For makers like me, it takes a lot of time and effort to make projects like this and put them in videos. So it's hard for me to post a video every week like YouTube's algorithm wants me to do. If you like what I am doing here, please like, share, subscribe, click the bell button, and let me know what you think in comments. This will help YouTube recommend my videos to other people too. Thanks for watching.